one and all to Bruton Parish Church, especially if you're new or visiting with us. We're very glad that you're here. You are welcome in this place, and that includes coming forward to the Lord's table and receiving the sacrament. When we arrive at that place in service, just follow the direction of the ushers and everything will be fine. And also, join us for coffee hour. It doesn't have to be a whole hour. Join us for a cup of coffee across the street. Little white house to the left of the garden called the Custis House. We would love to mix and mingle in a more personal way there. Host of announcements in your bulletins. Isabel Ware Birch will be here following this service to talk you through the needlepoint project and to show you the design for our new kneelers that will go around the altar rail to replace our tired kneelers that are there now. So they have served us valiantly, and we will retire them and replace them. Choral Evensong this evening at 5:30. ECW Luncheon coming up this week. The in-gathering, of the United Thank Offering, March 23rd, coming up. And this evening at 5:30 in the parish house, middle and high school youth and their parents are invited to a potluck. Also coming up this Saturday, March 22nd, the Canterbury Gala. If you haven't signed up for this thing, there is still time. Buy a ticket, come. It's a grand event, and it goes to a great cause. The Anglican School in San Pedro believes so you can do a good thing and have a good time. Life is not like that very often, so I suggest taking advantage of it when the opportunity comes. Last but certainly not least, next week we will bid our own Penny Nash farewell. I assume everyone has received correspondence from me. If you haven't, you should have. Since we mailed out a letter to everyone in the parish, we will bid Penny farewell following each of the Sunday morning services where she will be the preacher, and wish her well and thank her for her time. Again, welcome.
Thank you. not make for yourself any idol.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
You shall not invoke with malice the name of the Lord your God.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Honor your father and your mother.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
You shall not commit murder.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
You shall not commit adultery.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
You shall not steal.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
You shall not be a false witness.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
You shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Most merciful
God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Come, shall I hold. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. What then are we to say was gained by Abraham, our ancestor according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. But what does Scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who without works trusts him who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham, for he is the father of all of us, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations, in the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh. What is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, how can these things be? Jesus answered him, are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Ago, I sat at the feet of some of my great heroes to listen to them talk about the task of preaching. And they all offered many, many pearls of wisdom, all significant, but one thing really stuck with me. They all agreed and argued that one of the most important tasks essential to the work of the preacher developing the ability to see homiletically, to see the world through a theological lens, always being attentive to those moments where God is breaking in and being prepared to tell God's people and interpret for God's people the significance of those moments. They meant that the preacher always must be aware of what is happening around the world, in the country, in the church, or even at the corner bodega, to recognize moments of consequence for faith. Preacher must see God at work in the world, in life, to point to God at work in the world, in life. Now, this kind of vision isn't the sole preserve of the preacher, obviously. As people of faith, it is incumbent on all of us to be vigilant for things of the Spirit, to be aware of what God is doing in our lives, that we might respond to God's action. This is really part of the story of Nicodemus that we just shared this morning in the Gospel. We have only a general picture of Nicodemus. We're told that he's a Jewish leader, a Pharisee, a teacher, Jesus refers to him as. So we know Nicodemus is a person of faith that moves within the confines of the Jewish establishment easily. A person of faith. And he came to see Jesus. The text tells us that Jesus had made some sort of impression on Nicodemus. That Nicodemus had seen something in him, had heard about him, had witnessed his activities, and Nicodemus has come to him under the cover of darkness to see what Jesus is all about, and to seek to understand the authority and the origin of Jesus' teaching and activity. Nicodemus knew that God had to be in it somehow, given what he'd seen and heard. He needed to discover more. You see, Nicodemus was alert and attentive. Alert and attentive to God's activity in the world. And on the chance that God was doing something in Jesus, he acted, moved out of his comfort to discover more. Now, the traditional read on Nicodemus is that Nicodemus comes to Jesus at night because he is a leader of the Jewish establishment, and Jesus is already in trouble with the Jewish establishment, so he doesn't want to be seen as he goes to him for fear of criticism or some sort of reprisal. The traditional read also includes this idea that Jesus baffled Nicodemus completely with his phrases about being born again / born from above, and Nicodemus leaves confused. But there are scholars out there that are making a very different and a very compelling argument that has, I think, a lot of resonance. Nicodemus, yes, came to see Jesus because he was intrigued and thought that God might be doing something in Jesus. He came to discover more by engaging Jesus in a kind of rabbinical debate. If Nicodemus is a teacher of Israel, then he is equipped with the tools of the academy. So he went to Jesus to bring those tools, that mindset, his experience, gifts, and talents to bear. So Nicodemus went to see Jesus for a rabbinical sparring match. Now there's integrity to this. Nicodemus wants to know the truth, but he has a particular approach to seek the truth. Now, the first kind of tack in this rabbinical exercise would be to take shots at the low-hanging fruit, as it were. So when Jesus said, one must be born from above, / go back to the beginning, / be born again, his phrase has all of those meanings. Nicodemus kind of plays dumb with Jesus and takes a shot in the most literal, base way. I hear what you're saying, Jesus. You're making some interesting statements, but this born again, would you go back to your mother's womb? All right, smarty pants rabbi, tell me how that works. And Jesus takes a step back and holds Nicodemus' feet to the fire, effectively saying, don't play dumb with me. I know what you're doing. We know what we're doing here. And you know what I mean. In this exchange, Jesus placed his own ministry in the context of the age-old story of God saving Israel time and time again. The story of the working out of God's Spirit that's been moving in creation since the very beginning and has been a vehicle of creation. So when Jesus says to Nicodemus about being born from above, where the Spirit resides, he's invoking all of Israel's story. You see, Jesus reminded Nicodemus of the inscrutable nature of God's loving, delivering, Spirit-sending activity. And Jesus left Nicodemus to wrestle with himself and with God. To work with all of it, that he might understand, that he might see and know. Nicodemus might not have been able to fully grasp what God was doing in Jesus, but he was able to see that something was happening. He came to Jesus, carried by his own gifts and talents, by his own God-given sense of inquiry, to come to Jesus, to see, and to know. This is what undergirds the gospel in its entirety. The ever-living, ever-loving God of Israel is doing in Jesus what God always does, offering kinship and relationship. And the good news is that kingship is not dependent upon our ability to apprehend the hows and the whys, or even some satisfactory sense of what it all means. The good news, the news that caused Nicodemus to find Jesus is at night, is that God graces us with that sense of inquiry, that sense of intuition, that quest for meaning, to see and seek the light. Like Nicodemus, we come to Jesus with our particular ways of seeing and our particular gifts. We have our own questions. We desire our own answers. And we see Jesus penetrating the darkness with flickers of light, helping us to see, helping us to know more. God's given us all we need to. Through grace, we see. We see. Thank you.
people are found on page 388 of the Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Let us pray for Penny Nash as she prepares for her transition to her new calling. We pray for the College of William and Mary. We pray for the Holy Cross School in San Pedro, Belize. We pray for peace in the Middle East, the Ukraine, and Russia. We pray for the men and women of our armed forces. And we pray for your wisdom that we may be a unified people at peace among ourselves and a blessing to other nations. And we pray for all those listed in the bulletin for whom our prayers have been asked. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be always with you.
Thank you. Thank you.